So that brings us to Lamport's physical clock. And the notation we're going to use for that is this funny symbol here. So this is saying that in physical time, in real time, event A in the distributed system happened before B. So if I want to make sure that an event A in the distributed system anywhere happened in absolute real time before B, so PI, there's a process PJ, event A is happening on PI, and event B is happening on PJ. And what we want to make sure is that the timestamp associated with A has to be less than the timestamp associated with B if I want to guarantee that A in real time happened before B. So A in real time happened before B. That is how you have to read this notation, that in real time, the event A happened before B. And in order to satisfy that, the condition is the timestamp associated with A has to be less than the timestamp associated with B. So to guarantee this, and we are talking about real time here, so the real timestamp associated with A and B, in order to ensure that the real time associated with these events give you this guarantee, you have to have certain conditions associated with the clocks that are on the machines PI and PJ. And the first condition, which I'll call PC1, I'll refer to that as PC1 later on, the condition is a bound on individual clock drift. So PC1 is a condition which gives a bound on individual clock drift. Informally, what this condition is going to tell you is that the clocks don't drift that much. So let's talk about this. If what is the time that is read on process PI at time T? If T is the real time, at time T, real time T, I look at the clock on my machine, and that is CI of T. What should it read? Well, it should read T. Now, if it doesn't, that's when we are saying it is drifting with respect to T. And so what this equation is saying is dCi over dt is the clock drift. The absolute value of the drift is very, very small. So in other words, what we are saying is all the clocks in the distributed system, whether we are talking about CI on PI or CJ on PI, all these clocks are running approximately correctly so that the clock individual drift is very, very small. So K is the individual clock drift, and we are hoping that it is very, very small. And you can see that if CI of T is equal to T, then dCi of dt should be equal to 1, and therefore this will be a 0. So the left-hand side of this will be a 0, and so that's why we are saying that K has to be a very small number. The second condition is that the mutual drift between the clocks on different nodes of the distributed system should be very small. There should be a bound on mutual clock drift. So that is captured in this condition, saying that for all ij, any pair of nodes in the entire distributed system, the difference between the time that I read on my clock and the time that I read on somebody else's clock is very, very small. So this is the mutual clock drift. As I said earlier, at real time t, my clock should also be reading T. This guy also should be reading T. If it doesn't, that's when you have a drift. What we're saying is the mutual clock drift between any two nodes in the entire distributed system is bound by a small quantity epsilon. So K and epsilon are the two important parameters in the physical clock condition. Intuitively, we're going to argue that these values, the absolute values of these individual clock drift and mutual clock drift, has to be negligible compared to the inter-process communication time.